I think it is time. So, Risha, if you're ready, shall we start?
Yes.
Yeah, so it's a great pleasure to introduce Vyacheslava Nizirol from the Institute of Mathematics in Jussieu, Paris. And she will tell us about Hodge theory of periodic analytic varieties, please.
Thank you. So thank you, the organizers, for the invitation to speak here. And thank you for all the work, hard work, which must have gone into arranging the conference. So what I want to talk about is a little bit of a survey of the work we have done on periodic Hodge theory for analytic varieties. So most of what I will be talking about today is a joint work with Pierre Colmes, but there will be also a couple of other people maybe. And I will start with recalling what happens in the algebraic situation. So Hodge theory for periodic algebraic varieties. So the general setup is here at the top of the page. So we have a complete discrete valuation field, mixed characteristic 0p. We have Galois group of this field. C will be the completion of the algebraic closure. OK would be the integers in K and the residue field small k we assume to be perfect. And with letter F in general, I will denote the unramified analogs. So this would be bit vectors of the residue field K, or if they, OF would be just the bit vectors itself, etc. So I want to remind you the algebraic comparison theorem, which is classical by now. what I want you to note here is that I'm not assuming anything on X. So X is a variety over K, algebraic variety. It can be open, it can be singular. And we claim that we have a comparison theorem now. So I listed as two. One, the simpler one is the Deram comparison. So we compare etalco homology, geometric etalco homology. So you can think of it locally as the group cohomology, continuous group cohomology of the fundamental group of the variety. We compare it with the Deram cohomology. And here, because my X is anything, we have to take the Deligne-Deram cohomology, which is defined using resolutions of singularities. And they compare well with the using the period ring B-Deram, which is some kind of deformation of C. And this comparison theorem must be compatible with filtrations. So we have Deram filtration on Deram cohomology, Hodge filtration, and we have filtration on B-Deram, and these all should be compatible with these filtrations. Now, more subtle to prove and even to define is the other one, the PST comparison or ST comparison. Again, we have et al. And here we have this Hodge Hyoto-Kato cohomology, which I will explain in a moment, but you can think of this as some kind of extra structure on the Deram cohomology. So the field changes from K bar to the maximal unramified extension of F, so F and R. It's still finite rank, so everything is finite rank. But also, this now acquires Frobenius from characteristic P, monodromy from characteristic P, and there is some residual action of the Galois group, which comes from the fact that we don't have a semi-stable reduction of X over the base, but perhaps after some field extension. So this action remembers that you made this field extension. Okay. And now the period ring is also more subtle than the B-Deram period ring. It embeds into B-Deram, but also has Frobenius and monodromy. And you can think of it, if you are familiar with B-Cris, as a polynomial algebra in one variable over the crystalline ring. So, so two more words maybe on this page. That the Deram comparison here allows you to recover Deram cohomology from metal, but this is not so useful in application. You want to go the other way. And this one here allows you to recover both. So Hyoto-Kato and Deram from etal and etal from Hyoto-Kato. Okay, so before explaining how this goes, these functors back and forth, I want to make mention of, explain maybe this Hyoto-Kato cohomology. So Hidokatoko homology was introduced in this algebraic setting by Hyodo and Kato in their joint paper, but we will use the version of Bellinson. We generalize it to any variety over K using H topology. So let me just first state the definition of Hyodo-Kato. So just look at the top line here now and think of this as your model for a moment. So we have a smooth object over K, which is compactified now. It's compactified by this object here, but both vertically, that is, we have an integral model, and the special fiber is a divisor with normal crossings, but we also compactify horizontally, so you have a relative divisor with normal crossings, and these two are also divisor with normal crossings, so we have a total compactification into a proper variety, proper smooth variety over OK for the moment, let's assume that. And this open set here is also smooth. So in that setup, Hyodo-Kato defined crystalline version of Hyodo-Kato cohomology. So everything here now acquires log structure. So I will just skip over it, but everything has a log structure, which means we are attaching logs of some functions, of some regular functions on your schemes. So for example, here, the crystalline cohomology of the special fiber of this model remembers the log structure from the special fiber, and this object here is just vid vectors of the residue field, but the O here means that I am attaching formally log of zero. Okay, and this is our crystalline cohomology. You take it if you take it rationally, you get Hyodo-Kato cohomology. It has, in this nice setup, it has finite rank over this unramified field. It has Frobenius because we were in characteristic P, and it has monodromal, which comes from this D log zero here, from this tangent vector actually attached here. And also it compares with the rank cohomology. If you extend the coefficients to L in this, if you ask what is called Hyodo-Kato isomorphism. Okay, but in general, your X is neither smooth nor proper nor anything. So what we are saying is that what De Jong tells us that in H topology, we can find the covering by open sets U, which are smooth and which are compactifiable in this way. And but they are going to be compactifiable and over some extension. So semi-stable, but over some finite extension of OK, you have to allow for this extension. So then you can globalize it. So that's what Bellinson did, introducing certain modified notion of Verdier basis. But also in our case, we need to make everything geometric. I didn't want to draw the geometric picture, but everything has to be done over C, actually, or over OC. And then you glue this, and you obtain a global Hyodo-Kato cohomology, which is again a finite rank, but now it is over this maximal unramified extension of F. It has this structure, so phi n, and this action of gk comes from these extensions here. And we have a comparison with the rank cohomology with the Hyodo-Kato isomorphism. So that's kind of classical by now. And these two functors I mentioned, which go back and forth between etal and the RAM, can be now described very explicitly. So the RAM to etal comparison. So you start with the RAM data, which is the thing on the right, and you apply to it eigenspaces of Frobenius and monodromy, and then you take some Hodge level. And that you note, I didn't do anything with the Galois action. The Galois action still stays. Everything is compatible with Galois action. I recover a talco homology together with this Galois action. Okay, I don't like the way it's written here, so we twist everything by R and we want to write it in a different way. So yeah, instead of QP here, I take the twist QPR and I get now by Cartesian diagram. These two statements are actually the equivalent. So that is the comparison theorem is equivalent to the existence of this bicartesian diagram. So I introduced this shorthand for it because it's too much, too many symbols. So here is a Tarco homology. Here is this Hyodokato chunk, which is like that. The sub R refers to the twist and top R to the degree. Here is the Deram chunk, and here is the Hodge filtration chunk. So I denoted it in this way. And now what does bicartesian mean? Specifically, it's equivalent to the fact that if you build a total complex, you get an exact sequence. So you have an exact sequence of this form, and comparison theorem is in fact equivalent to this statement in the algebraic case. Now we can go the other way. So you can recover the RAM data. There are some duals, but nevertheless, and the Hyodokato data with all the structures, Frobenius filtration, etc., from the Talco homology. So here you take for the RAM, you take all equivariant Galois equivariant maps into BDRAM. Here you don't take just the equivariant, but you take the equivariant under any open subgroup of GK. That's why I wrote here GK smooth vectors of this homomorphism. This again accounts for this potentially semi-stable situation. So you get these two functors back and forth. So we'll try to see how much of that we can get in the analytic setup. So let's go to analytic varieties. So it's now, I think, 10 years or so that we made some progress. And it started with a result of Scholze for proper smooth rigid analytic varieties. He proved that a Talco homology, p-adic Talco homology, has finite rank. So the proof goes in two steps. First, you used Artin-Schreier to pass to coherent cohomology. And once you are in coherent cohomology, and this is coherent cohomology mod P, you can use Cartier-Serre kind of arguments to prove finiteness, so mimicked after similar arguments in the theory of analytic vector coherent vector bundles. I mean, coherent sheaves, sorry, cohomology of coherent sheaves. So you prove that if you are working mod P and you have one affinoid contained properly in another affinoid, then the restriction map actually maps cohomology into a finitely generated object. So you have this kind of shrinking. And also he proved that the Hodge-Deram spectral sequence then generates, and we get the RAM comparison theorem also with coefficients, and it has exactly the same form as for the algebraic setup. So everything here is finite again. At all cohomology is finite, the RAM cohomology is finite, so it just behaves the same way as algebraically in this sense. Now for the DRAM, how about for the more sophisticated comparison? This also can be done. And with COMES, we have proved it first for the varieties over K, smooth proper analytic varieties. So you have the DRAM comparison that Scholze gave us, but this can be now upgraded to PST comparison with appropriately defined Hyodokato cohomology. So you have to define this again, and then one can prove very similar result. So, but we know actually also that this can be lifted to, this also holds for smooth proper rigid analytic varieties over C. So all the way up. And few things change. So the main change concerns this factor here. Here, the RAM cohomology X was defined over K. So you had the RAM cohomology over K. But now X is defined over C. So what you would like to take here would be the RAM cohomology of X, tensor B the RAM over C, only the B the RAM plus. Sorry, there is a typo here. This should be tensored with BDRAM. The BDRAM plus doesn't have C structure. So instead, what we do, this was already disappeared already in Bad Morrow Scholze, the first paper. You define BDRAM plus cohomology, which kind of mimics this object if we had a C-structure over Biderum. Formally speaking, it's defined, I think Guo recently wrote a very nice definition, then the quote-unquote correct definition of this Biderum plus cohomology. So you look at X over C, but then spec of C embeds into the spec of Biderum plus. You have to choose your category in which you work. And it's a nilpotent kind of thickening, and you work within in the nilpotent side of Grothendieck, and everything works fine. So we have again a comparison theorem in the proper and smooth case. And so now I mentioned this Hyodokata theory for analytic spaces, where you have to be a bit careful in this case. We actually work with the original Hyodokata theory crystalline as well. But the one we also have to use is also the Grosse-Klonne definition. So we have a smooth Dagger variety. I will just work with smooth, so I don't need a H topology anymore. And again, locally, we take something smooth. This U here, it's smooth. It is still smooth. And I can find, let's assume that I can find a compactification, so integral model, but I have a normal closing divisor just vertically on the special fiber. I don't compactify horizontally. So there is just vertical compactification. Now in general, these models will not exist on OK level. So we have to do etal locales. You can find such models etal locally after some field extension again. And this is due to these kind of arguments are due to Hart and Temkin, who did it over K and over OC respectively. And then you just mimic what we have done before, but you are not using crystalline cohomology, but rigid cohomology. So what do I mean? So what changes? So in crystalline cohomology, you take your scheme, say in characteristic P, you embed it into something smooth, and you take a corresponding you take a PD envelope or like PD cube, and then you take the RAM complex of that. So here we embed it into a weakly so not into formal scheme but weakly formal object smooth, and then we also take a tube, and then we take the associated RAM complex. So if you like to think on the generic fiber, you just take the tube corresponding to the special fiber on the Dagger variety, which is the generic fiber of the weakly formal scheme, and you work there with the DRAM complex. So then you have a natural map from this object to the crystalline object, which because you have less, so to speak, less function here than in crystalline setup.
Sorry, what is U bar?
So this is an integral model of U, semi-stable, and that's it. It doesn't, yeah, that's it. No multiplicities, sorry, I should have mentioned this to start with. No multiplicities allowed. Is that okay?
So nothing is proper here, right?
No, we don't compactify horizontally, no.
I see, thank you.
But if we do the overconvergent theory here, then it's like compactifying, right? So we get something which still has finite rank, the cohomology is going to a finite rank, and all the operators as before, and we have Hyodokata isomorphism with the rigid cohomology of U here, so with the RAM cohomology. I should have written this in a different way. It's the RAM cohomology of U. And now again, we can do the geometric case. We can glue it in a topology, and we get global structures of the same type as before. So global Hyodokata, it's finite rank now over FNR, so maximally unramified extension of F, with all these structures and Hyodokata isomorphism.
So is X quasi-compact?
X is quasi-compact. No. No.
And yet H star is finite rank. Okay.
No, you are right. Very good point. Sorry. In general, it doesn't have to be compact, but for this statement, it has to be compact. Yes. Thank you. Thank you. Yeah, that's a typo. Another typo is here that I really want this K bar to be C. Should be C. So that's right. So okay. So let me mention that if it's quasi compact, then in fact we get something of finite rank. If it's not quasi compact, then you get a fresher. So at least everywhere I'm going to assume I'm countable at infinity, so I can cover with a sequence of open sets, quasi compact, and then I get a fresher object.
Thank you. Okay.
And okay, so this was the first case, proper case. Now if you turn to the second case, which was which we tried to work with, which were the Stein varieties. Still everything is smooth. We didn't really work with singular. So what does it mean Stein? Recall, we have a covering by affinoids, admissible covering, and this inclusion, so think about one affinoid or closed disk containing another properly in another closed disk. So what properties do we get? We get acyclicity of coherent cohomology, so zero in non-trivial degrees, but we also get this property here, number three, that is we want to compute proetal cohomology, and we can compute it by computing etal cohomology on all these pieces, so affinoids, and then going to limits. Everything has to be derived, but anyway. And of course, in general, this proetal cohomology is infinite dimensional, and Hodge-Dirac spectral sequence again obviously does not degenerate. So these are differences, so it's kind of perpendicular situation to the situation of the proper varieties. And then we proved DRM. Some part of this was done in collaboration with Gabriel Despinescu. We can work over C. We have Stein smooth rigid space. But in fact, technically speaking, Dagger affinoid is not, so overconvergent affinoid is not Stein, but basically everything works in the same way. Only maybe the structure of topological structure of these spaces is different. And then we are claiming we have this commutative diagram with exact rows. So what I want you to remember is that just restrict yourself to this square here. And this square will turn now is by Cartesian by this DRM. And here we have proetal cohomology. Here we have some Hyodo-Kato taken eigenvalues of. Here we have the Ram fellow, and there is no period rings anymore at the bottom. And here we have some cocycles, again no period rings. And these period rings are not necessary because we are in the Stein situation. So, okay, no, I didn't write it. So this diagram is by Cartesian, that is we have the long, short exact sequence again, proetal, sum of these two, and this guy. So that's a version. So this was actually one of our first computations, and it was very useful for the examples which come from arithmetic, so Drinfeld space or coverings of Drinfeld spaces, this kind of situation. Okay, so our main theorem, I want to state that, so we try to generalize these two examples. We claim that we have this bicartesian diagram, which allows us to recover proetal cohomology from this data. And what is this data? Here is the Hyodo-Kato term, which looks exactly like before. Here is the Deram term, but it has to have a period ring, be Deram plus now. We cannot remove it. And here is the Hodge filtration term, which has to be written in this way because we have no degeneration of Hodge Deram in general. So you take Deram twist by B Deram plus, you take Hodge filtration, the tensor filtration, and then you take cohomology. So you have to put it inside. And then we claim that this is by Cartesian. So proetal cohomology here. is given as the kernel of the map from this direct sum to this object. So we can recover parietal from the RAM data. Okay, but we can go the other way. If now we are over finite extensions of QP, so we can recover Hyodokato with all its structures from parietal cohomology by taking so never mind this pro here. So imagine that you are in a quasi-compact case where this would be just again smooth vectors, so equivariant under some open subgroup. So we liked this result when we guessed that it could be true, because here you have this parietal cohomology, which is a huge group, and we are saying that just using Galois action, you can find the Hyodokato inside this huge space, and moreover with all the operators which act on it.
Does the et al. Guy determine the pro et al.?
No. Once more, sorry.
So in point two, you say it's et al. To the RAM, but if I understand.
Yeah, no. I mean pro et al. Sorry, this is abusive. It's pro et al. Et al. is in fact much more difficult to figure out, and we don't have this kind of pleasant comparison theorem for et al. Cohomology.
No known comparison theorem between et al. And pro et al. at the moment. Okay, thank you.
Only I can tell you two things. So in our work, where we did compute et al. Cohomology, we computed it because we had a map from et al. To pro et al., and et al. was actually for some, and there was some action of a group, a reductive group G, and et al. Was the G-bounded vector in the pro et al. So that's why we could compute it. But in general, the map from et al. To pro et al. Is not injective. Okay, so nothing so simple will work. And okay, so can we recover the RAM cohomology? We say we can still by taking these equivariant maps into B the RAM, but we are not sure yet how to formulate even if we do anything about recovering the filtration. In fact, maybe this is also possible, but we didn't address this yet. Okay, so. So I'm assuming here that X was over K, but everything is actually done over C. It's just that these terms are more complicated. Okay, so the remarks I want to make is that this term, this Hodge term, the Hodge filtration term, which appears on the left and which is complicated in general, in the proper case is something very simple, right? Because you have the Hodge-Deram degeneration. So it's just filtration of Hodge-Deram tensor B-Deram plus, so tensor filtrations. And moreover, if you look at the horizontal arrows, in the proper case, those arrows are injective. Okay, in the Stein case, it was the opposite, right? If you look at the horizontal or affinoids, if we look at the horizontal arrows, now they are surjective in the Stein case, and there are some kernels which we described using the differentials. So these are two perpendicular situations. So you can ask, well, can you, for example, take a proper and cross it with Stein, and can you have comparison for that? So we tried to do it by hand. In fact, that example, and it didn't work. We got completely baffled down by these Hodge filtrations here. But we know now by this theorem I stated that this is true. I just want to make one remark before I go, is that we really have to equip everything with topology. So this is a little bit of nuisance, serious nuisance actually. So we work in the category of locally convex spaces. It's quasi-abelian categories, so it's reasonably good for doing homological algebra. So in practice, we work with one of its left heart which is abelian, which is an abelian category, and we just work there. Then the tensor products which we use are always projective and they have to be derived. By projective, I mean the tensor products which commute with limits. And over convergence we use everywhere for several reasons, but one of them is that we get good properties of these tensor products. So higher direct functors of tensor products vanish if we overconverge everything, and cohomologies are everywhere classical, meaning they are really one space instead of being a pair of spaces from the heart of this derived category. Okay, so this is all I mentioned at the moment, for the moment about the topology. So before the proof, I need to mention a few words about Banachian mesh spaces, because that's a main actor in the proof, and it's not omnipresent object yet. So let's look at some examples. So recall how a Talco homology was derived from the Deram cohomology. It was done by this formula. So to remember is that you have some Hjodokato part here and some Hodge Deram part here, and you intersect them. So this part here, Hodge Deram tensor Bideram, it's easy to understand. But what kind of object is this one here, the Hjodokato object? So what structure exists on this object? So you can forget this monodromy, you can untwist it using exponential, and this is the same as if you are allowed to forget the Galois action. And so it is basically Hjodokato tensor B Kreese plus, and you take Frobenius equal one part of this. So let's look at an example. If your Hjodokato is just isocrystal with slope P minus one, power minus one, then if you tensor it with B Kreese plus and look at this trivial eigenspace, then this is the same as looking at the eigenspace phi equal P in B Kreese plus. And now we know that inside of this phi equal P, we have the tight object T, for Benius on it acts by multiplication by P. And then we have this exact sequence. So we have extension of C by QP. So I will write this in this informal way as C plus QP. Okay. Now in general, you can look at, say, phi equal PM eigenspace of B Kreese plus, and you get this short exact sequence. And now Bideram plus mod TM, it looks like M copies of C. And here you have just one copy of QP. So informally speaking, we have MC dimension and one QP dimension. Okay. So in which reasonable category we can talk about this kind of notion? So we want to distinguish between C dimension and QP dimension, and we want to keep it. That is, we want two spaces which have different C dimension and QP dimension not being isomorphic, for example. So this category cannot be the category of topological vector spaces or locally convex topological vector spaces, because then we have this isomorphism. And the reason for that is that C, so we look at QP topological vector space, locally convex topological vector spaces. We have a basis for Banach spaces, and then we just add one more to the basis. So we have this isomorphism. But one can put on this kind of objects, one can put analytic structure or more geometric structure, which Colmes and Fontaine called the category of BC spaces, so Banachian mesh spaces now. And the spaces look like copies of C and copies of QP, but you are also allowed to subtract them, so divide by QP as we did before. And, oh no, we actually didn't, I didn't show you an example. And then the total dimension is the C dimension and the QP dimension as two different entries. And surprisingly, maybe, this turns out to be very good for doing homological algebra again. So we have additivity on short exact sequences. So that's not easy to prove, this third property. So examples. So Bideram plasmod TM, or I will call BM, has M C dimension and no QP dimension. So QP dimension we sometimes call height also. If we look at this eigenspace, but now kind of fractional, so phi to A is equal P to B, which we call UAB. This has B C dimension and A QP dimension. So I gave you example for when A is equal to one. But you also have something like C mod QP, which is C points of some Banach-Holmes space. And then you have C dimension one, but QP dimension is minus one, you divide it out by it. So it's kind of very stacky here. Okay, now in this analytic situation, the BC spaces are not going to be of finite as we mentioned, not always. But still there are manageable, so we call them QBC spaces. So this is something we introduced to kind of make things nicer. So when I gave a talk last summer about it, when we just figured out the proof, we didn't introduce this notion yet. So this actually, I think, makes things more elegant. So what is a QBC space? Well, it's a vector space in the sense with capital V and S, in the sense that it's a functor on perfectoid spaces. And then you have this filtration that the quotient here, it's a genuine BC space. And here, this fellow is a BM module. So B the Ram plus mod T, T to the power M module. So these are the spaces we will be working with. This will be enough for us. So what's an example? This is the typical example here. You take the Ram complex, you take B the Ram plus and you divide by the filtration M of the two of the tensor product filtration. So this is of course killed by TM and so this is a typical example. And generally remark that we check that everything what we needed I will state below for BC spaces extends to these QBC spaces. So we are okay. Okay, so how do we prove main theorem? So everything inside has to be equipped with this BC structure, which is not so easy actually. Then we reduce everything to quasi-compact situation. So we do it in the following way. So you are countable in infinity, so you can write your X as an increasing union of quasi-compacts. This is not properly strict inclusion anymore, just an inclusion. And then if I call CX this short exact sequence that we want to be exact, I mean this sequence which we want to be exact, then I have the same object for UN. And we are claiming that this CX is actually a direct limit of this CUNs. Projective limit. And so basically you need to control R1 lean. And you control it in two different ways. So for example, this here, the cutoff fellow here is really BC space. So you prove, you check Mittag-Leffler in the BC category, but you can imagine this is very finite category. So it has Mittag-Leffler. And then this filtration here part will contribute some coherent cohomology pieces. And again, you have to check that these are also these also have something like topological Mittag-Leffler, satisfied topological Mittag-Leffler. Okay, now we are in quasi-compact situation. And first thing we prove in this situation is that we reduced our statement that is exactness of this sequence for X quasi-compact to three other statements. One is that if I look at this pair Hyodokato-Deram, notice that we are just in Fontaine situation or classical situation. The Ram is finite, Hyodokato is finite. You have even some filtration here, which is maybe bizarre. And you have Hyodokato structure, FIN structure over here. So we claim this is acyclic. I will explain what it means. So it's not necessarily weakly admissible or admissible like in the algebraic situation, but still it's not random. It has this acyclicity property. Second property is that Proetal cohomology here, which is a QBC space, is going to be effective or positive in the sense of curvature. I will explain this. So again, it's not arbitrary. And third property is that since this is a QBC space, its QP part, the height part, has finite rank, and this rank is exactly the same as the rank of the Deram group. So one thing I want to point out is that these statements are equivalent, but for all R, that is, we need to play between, pass between R, R minus one, etc. So we cannot, they're not equivalent for one chosen R. You have to make them true for all R. So the idea is now to prove this last, we are going to prove this last sentence, this last property. This was the easiest to look at, that the height of proetal is the same as the dimension of the RAM. But I want to explain these two notions because they're quite interesting. So what can we say otherwise about this pair Hjedokato de RAM, which comes from geometry, analytic geometry, but still quasi-compact geometry. So we claim that we can say that they're acyclic. What does it mean? So you have a filtered phi n module, as we had. You have the phi structure and you have the filtered structures. The phi structure gives you kind of trivial vector bundle on the Farq-Fonten curve. And this filter structure gives you modification at infinity. So you get some vector bundle. And acyclic means that this vector bundle is acyclic in the sense of cohomology on the Farq-Fonten curve. So H1 vanishes. If you want to talk about Hardin-Narasimha slopes, this just means that this vector bundle has slopes positive, in Hardin-Narasimha slopes positive. And algebraically, we just mean that this arrow here is a surjection. So to compare it with Fonten notion of admissibility, there we always got the slope, slopes here zero. So this notion is relaxed, it's more general than admissibility. But still it's not arbitrary. And H1 vanishes, okay. Now this curvature we introduce to split. So curvature is kind of, so think about the whole category of BC spaces, and we have notion of positive, negative and zero curvature, and it is very similar to the positive. So BC spaces have a structure of Hardin-Narasimha category. So we can talk about positive slopes, zero slopes and negative slopes. And you would think maybe naively that we should just, I mean, use that this notion from Hardin-Narasimha and Narasimha filtrations and slopes to define this curvature. But in fact, it's a little bit subtler than that. And I want to explain this in a moment, maybe in a few words. So zero, so let's say with zero, curvature zero, which we call also affine simply, that means that our space is a successive extension of V1. So for example, like Biderman plus mod T squared. And the way to think about this is you have a coherent sheaf supported at infinity on your Farq-Fonten curve and its torsion, and you take H0. Okay, now positive curvature means you have no maps to the line. And you may think of example that H1, which has a structure, H1 of a vector bundle on the Farq-Fonten curve. This has a structure of BC and it's going to have positive curvature. Now negative curvature, so think about H0 of a vector bundle on the Farq-Fonten curve. This will have negative curvature. It will not embed in Biderman to some power. And so examples here, V1 has curvature zero, height zero. V1 more QP has positive curvature, so it has no map to V1 itself. Height, of course, is minus one because we modded out by QP. Now U, so F equal P eigenspace, has curvature negative and height one, again, as you have seen on examples. And here's a curious case. This is explains why we are not quite in Hardin-Narasimha kind of situation. So if you take U and mod out by the line QPT, you get just V1. This has curvature zero and height zero. But if you take any other line, so you take QPX for an element outside of T, you get positive curvature and height zero. So that's the reason why we are a little bit different from the Hardin-Narasimha filtrations. So for any BC space, we have filtration such that the graded pieces are from the top, negative curvature, zero, and positive curvature. So that's graded pieces. So that's a unique filtration. So all of this reminds us of Harden-Narasimha. So maybe I put this. So Lebrun, his thesis defined the Harden-Narasimha structure on this category of BCs. So we have a notion of a slope. And to give an example, if you take this UHD for relatively prime DH in the UHD, remember, was this eigenspace with where Frobenius to power H is equal P to power D, then this is going to have a slope equal to slope slope here of this should be alpha, I think. No, minus one. Okay, sorry. So this is going to have a slope minus one over lambda, where lambda is the over H. And there is a problem in working with Farcon Fontaine curve when you pass between vector bundles and isocrystals, etc. The signs change and the fractions change. It's very easy to get confused. So you can think of this U alpha as H0. If alpha is positive, H0 of the sheaf O lambda, sorry, lambda, or H1 of O lambda if lambda is negative. So from Harden-Narasimha structure, we get non-canonical splitting of the Hodge, of the Harden-Narasimha filtration, and we get these pieces here, which are U's, and this piece here, which is H0 of some torsion shift supported at the points of your curve. So all points, that's the whole point. And you want, so this is slope zero now, and these are slope, these guys have slope alpha, lambda one and lambda r, sorry. And now the curvature and Harden-Narasimha filtration translate into this following table. So zero, so affine so curvature zero, it just comes from H zero of the shifts, torsion shifts supported at infinity, so the distinguished point, not all of them. All the other, even though they have a slope zero, they belong to the curvature positive, so that's the difference. And the rest is kind of similar. But the main difference is we do distinguish infinity. So that's maybe not surprising, but we were confused about it at some point. Okay, so how much time I have left? I don't have any time left. So so let me just mention how you work it out in compact case very briefly. So we are in compact case. We want to prove that height of a tally is the same as dimension of the RAM. You don't have a direct map from proetal to the RAM. Well, it may be, but it's a kind of, it's complicated. So we want to argue by induction, and we replace this the RAM with Hyodokato because the dimension of the RAM is the same as the height of this Hyodokato term. So then we want to prove that height of proetal is the same as this height of Hyodokato. But now we have a map, and now you pretend that Hyodokato is not just the height is not just a number, but you pretend it's a map into an so you get an object of an abelian category, so you can lift it your numbers to objects of some abelian category, and this functor is exact. Imagine that. So you want to prove that your map here is actually an isomorphism after you apply height. And now you can argue by induction, by Meyer-Vittoris, right? You have it true for one affinoid, another affinoid, their intersection, which is still affinoid, and then you can pull it back to the union of two affinoids. So that was our original idea. And now all we had to do was to make sense out of this sentence here, which makes no sense. That is, we cannot categorify height kind of on the nose. You can only make it into a map, into an abelian category, if you restrict yourself to effective. And it's an exact functor if you restrict yourself to effective Banach-Holmes spaces. But this was enough for us. We've shown that everything inside is effective, And this functor we construct in by taking Holmes into be the rank, in fact, recovers height as the rank, so it's perfect on this category of effective, and then we show everything inside is effective. And that's the end of the argument. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I have a question very briefly. Is this written up, your talk already, or not quite?
Is it what?
The material you presented today, is it already in one of your papers or not?
No, it's not. It's something that we are still finishing.
Thank you. We've got